So good morning, we will continue our discussion on non-Newtonian fluids. Okay, so let me quickly revisit what we were discussing. So we had started discussing about different types of non-Newtonian fluid. I hope the screen is visible to you. Can somebody confirm?
Yes.
Okay, so we had started discussing about different types of non-Newtonian fluids, and we can classify them into two major groups. One is purely viscous fluid, okay, where the phenomena is time independent, means it does not depend on the time. So if any change in stress occurs, the strain also immediately changes, and the viscosity also immediately changes according to its constitutive relation, basically its properties. So the other type of fluid is time dependent fluid, where the change occurs slowly over a certain amount of time. Okay, so the first type of fluid again can be divided into different groups. We have discussed all of them. So the first group, which is the most popular, we already know, and like you guys have done all the fluid mechanics and all other types of calculations based on that, is Newtonian fluid. Okay, where the stress is linearly proportional to the strain rate. So the shear stress is linearly proportional to the strain rate. We write the equation like we have previously discussed, like tau xy is equal to mu del u del y. This is very familiar to all of us. Okay. So where del u del y is the deformation rate and tau xy is the shear stress. The other type is where we have already discussed that also, that shear stress does not increase or increases at a rate which is less than linear with strain rate. So if the strain rate is increasing, the shear stress does not increase as fast as the strain rate. Okay, this type of fluids are also very common. These are known as shear thinning fluids. Okay, what were the examples? We have discussed some examples like wall paint, blood, cream, nail polish, ketchup, liquid polymers. There are a lot of other examples also. You can just read in any online databases. Okay, the other type of fluid, so shear thinning fluid, we have already discussed now that the stress does not increase as fast as the strain rate. Okay, so it does not increase linearly, the rate is less than linear. The other type of fluid where the shear stress increases at a rate which is more than a linear rate is known as shear thickening fluid. Okay, so if you think in terms of some apparent viscosity. Viscosity can only be defined for Newtonian fluid. Okay, viscosity is the coefficient like this. So when we write the equation of stress and strain, the coefficient is termed as viscosity. So it can only be defined for Newtonian fluid because there only we have a constant coefficient basically. So this can change with temperature or other things, but it does not change with strain rate or stress. So viscosity remains constant with strain rate or stress. So that's why we define it like this. But for the other fluids, remember, remember that there may be some lag between my voice and the screen, the cursor that I'm showing on screen because of poor internet connection. Okay. So you have to bear with that. My voice may not sync with what I'm showing on screen. So anyway, so for shear thinning fluids, we can assume that the viscosity is gradually decreasing with increasing strain rate. Okay. For Newtonian fluid, the viscosity remains constant. For shear thinning fluid, the viscosity is decreasing. As some apparent viscosity, we cannot call it as viscosity, but we can call it as some equivalent or apparent viscosity. Okay. For shear thickening fluid, on the other hand, the apparent or equivalent viscosity is increasing with increasing shear rate. Okay. So more and more stress is required or force is required to create additional strain rate. What were some examples? Examples of shear thickening fluids are less. So some types of colloids and suspensions basically act as shear thickening fluid. I have shown you a video also, which where it is seen very nicely. It is uploaded in the portal also. You can check. Like if you hit it with a hammer, the hammer will just bounce back because it behaves with very high resistance. Or if you jump on the fluid, you can just jump on it and jump out of it without wetting your feet. But if you stand on the fluid, you will just gradually get submerged in the fluid. Okay. So So behavior is very different at high forces and very different at low forces. So that is the shear thickening type of fluid. Okay. And we have discussed that there is another type of fluid which is known as Bingham plastic or viscoplastic or yield stress fluid, where basically at to start the deformation itself, start the strain rate itself, okay, start the flow itself, you need a certain threshold amount of stress. Without that, the flow cannot start. Okay, so think of say toothpaste. So the toothpaste will not flow out if you just invert the tube. Okay, you have to press it with certain force, and then only the flow will start. Once the flow starts, the flow can occur similar to a Newtonian fluid. Means after that, the additional stress can increase linearly proportional to the strain rate. Okay, or it can increase like a shear thinning fluid after that. So I have not shown it here. It will become like this. So the line will have a downward, means the slope will change. Slope will get reduced with increasing strain rate. That is known as Bingham pseudoplastic. Okay, this is Bingham plastic. That is known as Bingham pseudoplastic. So the main difference is that you need a certain amount of initial stress for the flow to even start. Without that, the flow will not start. So there is a big difference between these two types, the shear thickening, shear thinning, and Newtonian, and the Bingham plastic. So this type of fluid, shear thinning, shear thickening, and Newtonian, if you keep them somewhere, they cannot hold their shape. Okay, based on the gravity, they will just go down. Say I cannot put a pile of water, right? The water will flow down and will gradually get distributed over the surface. But for shear, for this Bingham plastic type of fluids, they will hold their shape. Okay, so if you keep a small pile of something, so some Bingham plastic, it will be at its original shape. Okay, it will not flow down. Okay, but once you start pushing it, then it will. So say if I put a pile of jam or jelly, it will hold its shape. But if I start pushing it, then it will start flowing like a fluid. Okay, so the same thing. So that is a big distinction. Okay, it can hold its shape even without the help of any external container. But for this Newtonian shear thickening and shear thinning fluids, they cannot hold their shape without the help of any external containers. They will just flow down and spread out. Okay. So basically, this Bingham plastic acts like a solid at before it starts flowing. So at a stress which is less than the critical stress, it acts like a solid. So we'll go to the second. So this we had already discussed all this. So we'll go to the second type, which is known as timed, like the fluids with time dependent viscosity. Okay, so again there can be two types here. The apparent viscosity change means increases with time, or the apparent viscosity decreases with time. Okay, if the apparent viscosity decreases with time, we call it a thixotropic fluid. Okay, so say we apply a continuous force on this fluid. Okay, what will happen is that the apparent viscosity will keep on decreasing, so the deformation rate will keep on increasing. Okay, so this is more like somewhat like a creep phenomena. So what is happening is that although it's not exactly creep is for solid. So here what happens is that say there is a let me go back to our initial example. Okay, that is our initial example. Okay, there are two plates like this, and we have a thixotropic fluid, which is where the apparent viscosity decreases with time. Okay, and we apply some force here, say 10 Newton force, and the velocity initially is 5 meters per second. Okay, so there is some apparent viscosity we can easily calculate based on the shear stress, and means shear stress can be calculated based on the force and area, and the velocity will give you what is del u del y. Okay, so from that we can easily calculate what is the apparent viscosity. So for thixotropic fluid, the apparent viscosity decreases with time. So if I keep the force 10 Newton, gradually the top plate will start moving faster and faster. It will become 5, from 5 it will become 6 meters per second, 7 meters per second, 8 meters per second, like this. So actually, the viscosity is decreasing with time. Okay, so that's why the resistance becomes less and less, and for the same force, the fluid can deform at a rate which is increasing. Okay, so that is the difference. For time independent fluids, this will not occur. If you keep the force at 10 Newton, even if it is shear thickening or shear thinning, the velocity will remain as 5 meter per second. But the change that will occur is that if you increase the force to 20 Newton, the viscosity may not change, or it may change it may increase or decrease. So the velocity may not change at a linear rate. The velocity can increase at a rate which is higher than a linear rate or lower than a linear rate. But it is not going to get changed with time. Okay. Once you have changed the force to 20 Newton, immediately the velocity will change to 10 meter per second and it will remain as such. But for time dependent fluids, that is not the case. Any questions?
Sir, is there a limit up to which it will decrease or it will keep on decreasing?
Yes, so it depends on the fluid. Okay, so there is not like, you cannot call it like a theoretical limit. What will happen is that, let me give some example and then you will understand why there is a limit. Okay, so some of the examples are like semi-solid metal, clay, okay, yogurt is curd. So semi-solid metal, let us take the example of semi-solid metal. Okay, what is a semi-solid metal? Semi-solid metal means it is in a two-phase region, means there are dendritic structure. I hope you know what a dendritic structure means. Some solid has already formed. Okay, so say I am solidifying a liquid metal. Okay, at some point, if it is an alloy, at some point it will have a mushy region. It means that there are some solid parts there and some liquid parts. Okay, the solid parts are in a branch tree like structure which we call as dendritic structure. So some dendritic structure has formed, and in between there are liquids. Okay, there is liquid, it's filled up with liquid. So this material, we call it as semi-solid material, okay, semi-solid metal. So when you apply some force on this semi-solid metal, okay, so initially it will act like a solid. If you take out a semi-solid metal from the furnace, you will see as if this is a solid object. Okay, now say you apply some force, you put it in a mold, say high pressure die casting. So there we put it in a mold and we put a huge amount of force. Okay, like a piston cylinder arrangement, we put a very huge amount of force through a piston. Okay, so what will happen is that all the solid structures that are there, the dendritic structures, will break down into smaller and smaller particles. Okay, so the resistance that was initially taken up by the solid structure will go away. So ultimately it will become like a liquid with very small particles in it. Okay, so the resistance will go down drastically, and it will behave more and more like a lower viscosity liquid. Okay, so this is why with time actually there is change in apparent viscosity. Apparent viscosity decreases with time because the solid network was carrying lot of stress, and now it cannot take lot of stress because it has got fractured into smaller particles. Okay, so obviously at the limit it is still a fluid, right? It cannot, so the fluid itself has some inherent viscosity, so the viscosity cannot become zero. So ultimately, theoretically, at the limit, it can go to the viscosity of the fluid. Okay, but obviously, the viscosity cannot become zero. Is it clear? Yes. Your question? Okay. So ultimately, you can say that if theoretically all the solid particles get distributed into very fine particles, then also the viscosity of the fluid is still there, and that will be the limit. Okay. The second type of time dependent fluid is known as rheopectic fluid. Okay, not very common, but still an important area. Okay, so where the apparent viscosity increases with time. Okay, this is somewhat similar to our shear thickening fluid, like the colloids and suspension, somewhat similar to that. Okay, there is not a very, say, theoretically there is a distinction, but in real life, in practical life, there is no hard distinction between the shear thickening fluid and this rheopectic fluid, because the shear thickening fluid will take at least some amount of time to react to the change in stress. Okay, so it will be ultimately like a rheopectic fluid. The viscosity increases with time, so it is like a colloid where the particles come together and create more and more resistance. Some examples are printer ink. Okay, so all these are again type of some type of suspensions or colloids. Some type of lubricants also behave like this. Okay. So this is the second major classification. Actually, there are three major classifications. I was wrong when I said two major classification. I said that because there are two major classifications based on time. One is time independent and one is time dependent. Okay, there is another type of classification which is somewhat different, which is known as viscoelastic fluid. Okay, so it behaves as a combination of elastic and viscous material. I will come into what is an elastic and what is a viscous material in a second, but let me first define this material, viscoelastic material. Okay, so it behaves based on a parameter which is known as relaxation time. Okay, if the force acts very fast, or if the change occurs very fast, this object acts like a elastic material. Okay, elastic material is like a solid object. So the resistance to the force is like how a solid will act. Okay, if the time is very long, if it is greater than some relaxation time, some critical time you can say, or cutoff time, it behaves more like a viscous material, like a normal fluid. Okay, so it shows the behavior of both viscous and elastic materials. At very short duration, it shows the behavior of an elastic material. At very long duration, it shows the behavior of a viscous material. And near the relaxation time, it's a combination of both the behaviors. These type of materials are known as viscoelastic materials or viscoelastic fluid. Okay, some type of polymers are there which act like viscoelastic material. There is also putty. Okay, putty, you might know what is a putty. Okay, putty also acts like a viscoelastic material. If you throw a ball of putty very hard onto a wall, it will try to bounce back. Okay, because it, yes. Relaxation time is a critical time. Okay, some sort of critical time. We will discuss about viscoelastic material in detail later on when we solve some problem. But it is a time for individual time for each different material. It will be a different time below which the object behaves like a solid, above which the object behaves like a liquid. Okay, it depends on the molecular structure of the fluid. Okay, so we can, for our course, we can just assume that it is like a cutoff time. If the change occurs very fast, say relaxation time is 10 seconds. Okay, if the change occurs in 0.1 second, if the force is applied, very high force is applied for 0.1 second, the object will behave like a solid. If I apply a continuous force for say 100 seconds, the object will behave like a fluid. Okay, so this cutoff time of 10 seconds is the relaxation time. Okay. So actually, it will become clear. Actually, it's a combined property of solid and liquid. These fluids have combined property of both solids and liquids. And we will do, we will solve, or we will discuss different models of which can capture this behavior. Okay, using springs and dashpots. Okay, springs and dampers to capture this behavior later on in our course. It will be more clear there what is a relaxation time. Okay. At this moment, you just assume that it is a cutoff time below which it may be this fluid behaves like a solid and above which the fluid behaves like a liquid. Okay, so say this putty. Okay, if I throw a ball of putty very fast, okay, it will bounce back or try to bounce back like a solid. Okay, it will not flow, at least it will get stuck, but it will not flow. If I just keep a putty with some force, gradually it will start flowing slowly and slowly and will spread over the surface. If you apply a constant force, it will spread over the surface. So somewhat similar to pitch also. Pitch also, if you keep for long time, pitch is the material with which you make the road, right? So I have done in my young days one experiment. So we kept a ball of pitch for many months, okay, and gradually it became flatter and flatter, and ultimately it behaved like a fluid. But if you just keep it for a short duration without any force, it will behave like a solid. Although actually it's a type of Newtonian fluid, but I'm saying this, giving that example here, because the viscosity is so high for pitch that it behaves more like this. Okay, there's a very interesting, yes.
Sir, even in creep, with the help of its own weight, the material starts to sag, then yes. What is the difference in both of them?
Good question. So creep is for solid. What happens is that so yes, in even in creep, what happens is that if you held you keep a constant force, right? You keep a constant force. Say it is its own weight or some force. Like there is a material and you hang a weight below it. Okay. So what is creep? It's a phenomena where at a constant force, the deformation becomes more and more, right? I guess all of you know that. So in comparison to an elastic material is like a spring, where if you keep a constant force, the deformation will be constant. So the spring will elongate for a certain length and then it will remain there. It will not keep on elongating more and more. That is known as elastic behavior, right? So if I put a weight, say I have a spring and I put a weight of 10 kg, on the spring will immediately elongate by a certain amount to resist that force. The amount you can easily calculate based on the spring constant. So k into delta x will give you the force. Okay, and it will remain at that length. But for creep, or a material which undergoes creep, the spring will keep on elongating with time, although the force is kept fixed. Okay, so there the deformation changes with time. Okay, in case of fluids, forces do not change the deformation. Forces change the deformation rate. There is a big distinction. Okay, I will come to that. That's why I said that I will come into what is elastic and viscous material. Okay, so it's a good question. So I will discuss in a minute what is elastic and viscous material. So the force is not resisted by deformation. It is resisted by deformation rate of deformation. Okay, so it is not resisted by some change in length which has occurred. So it will not change the length. It will change the rate at which the length is changing. Okay. So it might sound confusing to you at this moment. Let me distinguish between solids and liquid and it will become more clear. But I hope I have given some idea at least about what is the difference. Okay. Okay. But first let me distinguish between what is a solid and liquid. Okay. In terms of this type of behavior. Before going to that, I was talking about an interesting experiment. You should all read about that, okay, because we are reading about this viscosity and stuff. There is a very interesting experiment which is going on for many years. It is one of the longest running experiment. I guess many of you might know about this. It is known as the pitch drop experiment. How many of you know about the pitch drop experiment?
Yes, sir.
All of you know about it?
Yes.
Very, very interesting experiment. Just read about it in Wikipedia. Okay, pitch drop experiment. So it started. It's running for more than, I think it's more than 100 years now, or around 100 years old, where a professor kept a certain amount of pitch in a funnel. Okay, I think we can. Pitch drops. All movie names are coming out because nobody is interested in science. So he kept, I hope you can see the screen, some amount of pitch in a funnel. Okay, so pitch is more like a solid. People used to think like it's like a solid object. Okay, but actually it's a fluid. Okay, and highly viscous fluid. So over time it flows out of the funnel, forms a drop, and it falls down on the jar below. Okay, so it started. When was it started? They said that. Timeline started in 1927, so not yet 100 years old, but almost like 100 years old, right? One of the longest running experiment. So each of the drop takes a few years to form and fall. Okay, and you can calculate the viscosity based on that. Okay, so the 8th drop, for example, they have stated that it fell on 28 November 2000. Okay, and I think the 9th drop fell on when did it fall? So how many times? 9 drop fell on 2014. Okay. So next drop will fall sometime in 2028 or something like that. Okay. So now it is put in a controlled environment. Previously it was not in a controlled environment, so the viscosity was slightly changing. But it's a very interesting experiment which gives you a mean of calculating experimentally the viscosity of pitch. And the viscosity is so high, you can assume that how much time it is taking to for each drop to form and fall. But it behaves like simple like water or honey itself, but on a very long time scale. Okay, so it's a very interesting experiment. You should read, all of you should read about this pitch drop experiment. Let us come back to our question. Okay. So what is the difference between solid and liquid? Fundamental question. So if you think in terms of, say, if you do not know, if you just a layman, you will say that solid can hold this shape and liquid cannot hold this shape. Okay. But in a more scientific way, if I think about what is a solid and what is a liquid, okay, it depends on how they resist a force. So when you apply a force on a solid, okay, say you have a spring which is a solid, when you apply a force on this solid, okay, typical solid, okay, I am not talking about creep and other things at this moment, just assuming that's a typical solid, what will happen to that solid if it's an elastic solid or like a normal solid, like say metal or any material, you take any normal day-to-day material. Metal is a very common example, any metal like aluminium. Okay. If I apply a force, it will deform, right? If I apply a force in the longitudinal direction, it will elongate. If I apply a torsion, kind of like torsional force, it will twist. So ultimately, it is going to deform. Okay. So a force is resisted by a solid object by deforming. Okay. Or you can say that, what is deformation, by the way? Deformation is that, say some particles are there in the solid and there is a distance between these particles. Okay, if I draw two lines on a solid, there's a distance between these two lines. So when it is deforming in response to a force, the distance between the lines are increasing, or the particles, the distance between the particles are increasing. At a very fundamental level, this is how you can explain solid, like it resists a force by deforming. Is it clear to everyone? Very, very, very basic thing I am explaining, right? All solids will react to force by deformation. Any questions on this very basic principle?
It means only you are considering elastic deformation.
Yes. That is how typically solids will deform. After that, there can be plastic deformation, but even if there is plastic deformation or creep or anything, the force is resisted by deformation. Okay, deformation means strain. So it is resisted by strain. It may be resisted in a linear fashion, by a non-linear fashion, or it may vary with time, like in creep. But ultimately, it is resisted by deformation. Okay, not deformation. The response to force is generation of deformation. If you increase the force, the deformation will change. Okay, whether it is elastic material, plastic material, or if it is behaving like if there is creep that is happening, it does not matter. Like all those depend on whether it's linearly varying, non-linearly varying, things like that. But ultimately, the important thing is that there will be deformation. Means the space between two particles will increase. Okay, but once it increases, it will remain as such. Okay. Unless it's like a creep, but in that case also the space will keep on increasing, but it will be like the deformation is changing. Okay, in fluid, in contrast, deformation is not deformation does not resist force. If you do not put a force on a fluid, still it can deform. Okay, even if there is no force on a fluid, okay, it will keep on deforming at the same rate. Okay, so a fluid can flow without any force also. If there is no friction or anything, it can just flow without any force also. Okay, what is the thing which is resisting a force in a fluid? It is the rate of deformation. Okay, so there is a distinction between deformation and rate of deformation. Rate of deformation is how fast the deformation is changing in the fluid. If the deformation remains constant in the fluid, okay, if the deformation remains constant, say there was some fluid and it has gone to a new shape. It cannot resist any force with that. Okay, so I had some water which was kept in a container. I poured that water in on a table. The water went to a new shape. Okay, it went to a new shape. It spread out and it went to a new shape. It is not resisting any force. Okay, but if I apply some force, what will happen? There will be a shear stress which will be developed in the water. Means the water layers, one layer of water will move at a faster rate as compared to another layer of water, and as a result, the deformation rate, the rate at which deformation is occurring, will change. Okay, so that is what is going to resist the force. So say if I go back to this experiment, this experiment, although it looks very simple, can give us huge amount of insight. Say this is a solid block. I hope all of you can see this. Okay, there are two plates. Instead of two plates, assume that this is a solid block. I apply a force on the top. What do you think will happen if it is a normal material like metal? If I apply sufficient force, or any small force also, if I apply a very small amount of force or some force, if it is a solid block, what will happen?
It will deform,
and it will deform in this way only, right? Means like the top surface will move and the bottom surface will remain fixed if I hold the bottom surface fixed. So there will be a shear strain, right? Shear strain means there will be change in the distance of the so along the y direction there will be change in the position of the of each of the particles along the x direction. So I mean that the particles will move along the x direction, but the rate of movement or the change in movement will be defined for different y positions. Okay, so the top particle will move farther away, the bottom particles will move very less amount. So but once this movement has occurred, it will just stay at that. So it will become deformed. If you hold the force, it will remain deformed at that position. Okay, now if it is an elastic material, if you remove the force, it will come back to its original position. If it is a plastic material, if you remove the force, it will not come back to its original position. But the change has occurred is similar. Okay, if you had applied a force, it has just deformed. Okay, but once it has deformed, it is not going to keep on flowing. The material is not going to keep on flowing. Okay, what happens in the fluid? If I apply certain force, okay, the top surface will keep on moving. It will not stop. Okay, it will keep on moving. The force will be resisted by the strain rate, not strain. Okay, so what is strain? Shear strain. Dx dt. Sorry, dx d del x del y. Okay, in that case, in this case, it will be del u del y. So u means that velocity. What is velocity? It is the rate of movement with time, right? So how fast is something moving with time? Okay. So when you say del u del y, it is how fast the particle is moving. Say any particle along any length in the y direction, how fast is it moving as compared to another particle which is below this. Okay, so because the particles, all of them are not moving at the same rate, okay, there exists a resistance in between. Say the top particle is moving at a faster velocity, okay, 5 meter per second. The lower particle is moving at 4 meter per second velocity. So as a result of these differences, there will be a resistance that is developed, and that is what is going to resist the force. Okay, so the force is creating, or force is being countered by that resistance. It was not the case for solid. Okay, so this is, you think about this and then you ask in the next class, okay, if you are not clear. So what is the fundamental difference between a fluid and a solid? There is a fundamental difference. In one case, it is the deformation which is resisting the force. In another case, it is the rate of deformation which is resisting the force. Deformation is not resisting the force. Okay, so if the fluid deforms and remains at that state, there will not be any force. Okay, only if the fluid keeps on flowing and the top surface keeps on moving, then only there will be a force in the fluid. But in the solid, if it deforms, still there will be a force. I will give another example of that of spring. Okay, you put a weight on a spring, it will deform. Okay, and if it deforms, it will deform by a certain amount and it will just stay at that position. Okay, So the deformation is resisting the force created by the weight, okay, in the resistance. But if you consider a damper, damper is a like a contains a viscous fluid, okay. It's shown by dashpot arrangement. We will discuss this later, okay. So maybe I have a picture here somewhere. We are going very slowly. Maybe we will need some extra classes. Number of classes are too less. Actually, we will discuss about creep also in detail later on, because fluid also shows creep behavior. Okay. This viscoelastic fluid. Come to that. So a damper is a substance. Say you have a piston and a cylinder arrangement. Okay. And the piston is immersed in a viscous fluid. Okay, like say any fluid is viscous, right? Water is also viscous fluid, honey is also viscous fluid, lubricant, oil, anything. So now the fluid is free to move around the piston. So the piston can be forced inside or outside. What will happen if I press the piston? The fluid will move around the piston and come towards the outer side of the, means on the top surface of the piston. If you pull the piston, the fluid will move around and go to the inside of the piston. So in this type of devices, the force is resisted by the rate of deformation, okay, the velocity of the piston, not by the deformation. So in those cases, the resistance is because of the viscosity. You can easily calculate what is the viscosity. The force is resisted by the viscosity of the fluid. It is, so if you keep on, so now I will explain the difference. If you keep on a certain amount of force, it will keep on deforming more and more and more and more. Okay, it will just not deform to a certain extent and stop there. It will just keep on deforming more and more, like creep phenomena. It is similar to a creep phenomena, you are right. So it will keep on deforming more and more and more. Okay, if I hold the force, if I stop the force, if I lower the force, still it will keep on deforming, but at a lower rate. Means the piston will move, but with a lower velocity. If I even reduce the force even further, even then the piston will move, but even at a lower velocity. Okay. If I make the force zero, then only the piston will stop moving. In contrast, if you have a spring and if you pull the spring with a certain force, with a large force, it will deform and it will stay in that shape. If you lower the force, the deformation will be lowered. Means the length of the spring will be lowered and again it will assume the new shape. If you lower the force, again it will be, the deformation will be lowered, length will be lowered and it will go to the new shape. Only if you go to zero force, even if you go to zero force, it will go back to its original shape. Okay. But what happens if you go to zero force in this dashpot arrangement, okay, piston cylinder arrangement? If you go to zero force, it will remain at its new position. It will not come back to its old position. Only what will happen is that velocity will become zero. I guess I am complicating more and more by bringing in more information. But these things are very fundamental. You have to develop your own insight into this. Okay. So at a fundamental level, solid and fluids behave differently. Okay. And that you have to understand. Questions? No questions. Is it clear? Nikhilesh, are you there?
Yes, sir. Now it is clear, sir.
Okay. So, already time is running out today. So, I will just start with some of the basics. We want to do mathematical calculation, like derivations. So we just don't want to stop at learning the basics of viscous non-Newtonian fluid. We want to do, at least for the simple type of non-Newtonian fluids, we want to do some calculations. For complicated type like time dependent fluid, it's not possible for us. So what we are going to do in this course is we are going to study this basic shear thickening fluid in lot of detail mathematically, and then viscoelastic fluids, which are very interesting, that also we will discuss in some detail later on. Okay, we will do some mathematics like the spring and dashpot arrangement that I showed. Those type of models can be applied to viscoelastic fluid. Okay. So to start analyzing viscous fluid, we have to define a few parameters. You don't have to memorize them. If there is in the exam, I will supply these materials. And here also, I have kept a sheet. You can see in your file section, in the notes section, that there is a sheet called governing equation. If you go there, all the governing equations are there. So you don't have to memorize these governing equations and other equations. Lot of governing equations are there, but you have to know what it means. Okay, so that is the thing. So we will start with the meaning of a few of the terms which are required for our analysis. Remember, you don't have to memorize, but you should know what are the meaning of these terms. Okay. Without these basic definitions, we cannot mathematically treat this non-Newtonian fluids. Okay, that's why we have to go through this initial terms. So first term that we are going to define, okay, we'll just quickly define, we'll not go into the physics of any of this, is known as velocity gradient tensor. Okay, I hope everybody knows what is a tensor. Okay, the first term is a velocity gradient tensor. It is defined as gradient of velocity. Gradient is gradient vector, I guess everybody knows, del del x I plus del del y j plus del del z k means the change in the x, y and z directions. Okay, so that is captured by the gradient vector. So if you take a gradient of velocity, velocity itself has three terms like vx or u in the I direction, x direction, v component in the j direction or y direction, and w component in the k direction or z direction. Okay, u component along the x direction or I direction, v component along the j direction or y direction, and w component along the k direction or z direction. Okay, so I can write v as vxi or ui plus vj plus wk. Okay, like this. So because it already has three components, and again you are taking a gradient, so ultimately it results in a nine component system. Okay, so if you take a transpose of that, transpose of a matrix you have studied in your linear algebra plus two or in first year of maths here. Okay, if I take a transpose of that, parameter is known as velocity gradient tensor. Okay, it is defined by L. And I can write each of these individual components as, you might get confused here, but once I show you the actual structure, it will become very easy. Okay, so I can write the individual components Lij as del Vi del Xj. Okay, where I is the number of row of the tensor or matrix, and J is the number of the column. Okay, and Vi is the velocity component. Okay, so say for example, V1 is U, V2 is V, V3 is W, and Xj again is the direction component. So X1 is X, X2 is Y, and X3 is Z. Okay, so in 3D, for 3D, I can simply write it like this. Okay, so remember that Lij is del Vi del Xj. Okay, so first one will be L11. First term is first row, first column. Okay, so del U del X. Okay, so that's why it is del U del X. Then L21, what is L21? Second row, first column. Okay, second row, first column. So second row, first column will be del V2 del X1. So V2 is V. Okay, so that's why it's del V, and X1 is X. So del V del X. Okay, then third row, first column, L31 will be third component of velocity. So del W. Okay, del W, first component of direction. So X del X, so del W del X. Similarly, you can write all the other terms. Okay, in the J direction, it will be del U del Y del U del Z. Okay, so this is the velocity gradient tensor. This is a very important term because it gives us information about how much deformation is occurring. Okay, so rate of deformation, not deformation, rate of deformation, because velocity gives us rate of change of movement. And in any direction, it gives us the rate of change of movement in any direction with respect to that direction. So it gives us the deformation. So now we can write this velocity gradient into two parts. Okay, I can write this as L as half L plus L transpose. Do you know what is transpose? L transpose will be that all the terms Lij will get converted to Lji. Okay, so this will become del U del X, del V del X, del W del X. Okay, and this direction will become del U del X, del U del Y, del W. Sorry, del U del X, del U del Y, del U del Z, like this. Okay, So if I write in this way, half L plus L transpose plus half L minus L transpose, you can add this and you will see that half L transpose minus half L transpose, this gets cancelled. So you are left with half L plus half L. So L, okay. So we can just write like this. So L is equal to half L plus L transpose plus half L minus L transpose. So this L plus L transpose, this is known as, this will be a symmetric matrix. If you do this, you just do it on your own, okay. After like any time before the next class, you write what is L transpose and you add L and L transpose. You will see that it will be a symmetric matrix, means across the diagonal, this component and this component will be similar. Similarly, this component and this component, if you reflect across the diagonal, it's similar. Okay, that's why it's symmetric matrix. This component and this component will be similar. So you can just across the diagonal, so Lij is basically equal to Lji, like this will happen for this symmetric matrix. Okay, this will be an anti-symmetric matrix. You can write this and I will find what is an anti-symmetric matrix. Okay, we are interested only in the symmetric part. Okay, but let us still define what is the symmetric part called. So half L plus L transpose, this symmetric part is known as rate of deformation tensor. Okay, it is known as rate of deformation. Okay, how fast this deformation is occurring along the 9 directions. What are the 9 directions? Like the deformation is occurring in the x direction, and what is this change with respect to the x direction? Okay, like a normal stress, you can, normal strain, you can say. What is the change in normal strain along the x direction, y direction, z direction? And then what are the change in the shear stress along the x, y and z direction, like this. Okay, so this rate of deformation tensor, can each component can be defined as, just from this you can find it out as half del vi del xj plus half del vj del xi. Okay, or this, from this you can find that out. Okay, just spend some time after the class today, because these are very important. Half del vi del xj plus half del vj del xi. Okay, dij is like this. And this anti-symmetric part is given by, is known as vorticity tensor. Okay, it gives us a measure of how much the fluid is rotating. Okay, how much the fluid is rotating. First part gives us a measure of how much the fluid is, what is the rate of deformation in the fluid, and second part is, there is no deformation, but it is, the change is occurring because of rotation. Okay, so change in position is occurring because of rotation. Okay, in the first part, the change of position of the particles is occurring because of deformation. In the second part, the change of position of the particles is occurring because of rotation. So rigid body can also rotate, right? I can rotate a stick, and then also the change of particle, the position of the particles will occur, but it is not going to deform. But still the change of position of the particle will occur, and that is because only of the rotation. Okay, if I rotate a stick, the position of all the particles will change, but actually there is no deformation. Okay, it's only because of rotation that is occurring. So similar thing is defined in terms of vorticity. Okay, and it can be defined as half del vi del xj minus del vj del xi. Each component you can define. What will be the diagonal components of this, of this matrix, vorticity matrix? For the diagonal, it will be zero. Right? All the diagonal components will be zero. Correct. Good. Because the I and G are same in the diagonals, right? So del vi del xj is equal to del vj del xi. Okay. And in the diagonal components, I and G are same. Here, first component I is 1, J is 1. Second component I is 2, J is 2. Third component I is 3, J is 3. Okay. So it will be del u del x minus del u del x, del v del y minus del v del y, and del w del z minus del w del z. So anyway, we are not going to go into any further details of this vorticity tensor. We will be limiting our scope to rate of deformation tensor, okay, because that is of interest to us. So that is what is going to resist the force. Okay, but in general, L can be written as, L is the change in velocity that is occurring. So that is given by velocity gradient, and change in velocity can occur because of two things. One is because of deformation, second is because of rotation. Okay, so L can be written in terms of deformation plus vorticity. Okay, we will define another term. Okay, here, so we are not going to use any more L and W. We are just going to use D. from now onwards. Okay, because that is the only important part for us. L and W just we defined just to define D. Okay, but we will be focusing on D only. So if we know what is D, that is sufficient for us, because D is the rate of deformation. So now you can ask that, or later on this question may arise after we go through some more material, that in this simple case we had found that tau xy is equal to mu del u del y. Okay, so and I had stated that tau is equal to mu into D, rate of deformation. Okay, this D is the same D, but here it was only for one direction, one component along the like xy direction. Okay, so the change that was occurring in the x direction with respect to the y direction. Okay, so change in the x component of velocity with respect to the y direction. Okay, so in general I can have 9 components of deformation, and similarly I will have then 9 stresses. It can be shear stress or normal stress, but I will have 9 components of stresses and 9 components of deformation. Okay, so that's why I have written this general equation tau is equal to mu d. So this tau will be also a 9 component matrix, like 3 by 3, and d also is a 9 component matrix, 3 by 3. Okay, and mu is the constant of proportionality. Only because of simple cases we write, where the change is only occurring in one direction, we write tau xy is equal to mu del u del y. In general we have 9 components of stresses and 9 components of deformation. How many distinct components are there for the deformation? 9 components in total, but how many distinct? Because it's a symmetric matrix, right? By definition, we have defined this to be a symmetric matrix. So, yes. Answers. This component will be similar to this component, right? 6 components will be there. 6, 3 in the normal direction and 3 in the shear direction. Okay, so 6 distinct components will be there, and 6 distinct stresses can develop, 3 normal stresses and 3 shear stresses. Okay, we will define another parameter which is known as strain rate. Okay, gamma dot or nu dot. Okay, so this gives us the magnitude of strain. If there are multiple strains in many directions, okay, multiple deformation is occurring in any direction, what is the overall magnitude of that? Okay, this is defined in this form. You don't have to go into why it is defined in this form. Just assume that it is defined in this form. 2d11 square plus d22 square plus d33 square plus 2d12 whole square plus 2d23 whole square plus 2d31 whole square. Then square root of the entire thing. Okay, where d11, d22, d33 are the, and d12, d23 and d31 are the components of the deformation, rate of deformation tensor. Okay, I am saying deformation tensor, but it is rate of deformation. Deformation is not correct. Okay, this is a rate of deformation. Velocity terms are there. Okay, rate of deformation tensor. So we have already defined D, so you can already know what is D11, D22, D33, D12, D23, D31, and you can find out what is the strain rate. Okay, let me just still elaborate, because it may seem confusing. I have actually written down what are these different components. Okay, we will keep this open here. Okay. So the different components of D will depend on the coordinate system. Okay, for example, for rectangular coordinate system, I am writing it down. For other coordinate system, it will be more complicated, and you have to find it out later on. Okay, from the charts, you don't have to memorize. So D11 is dxx. Okay, so what is D11? In this term, it will be half del u del x plus del u del x. Okay, so half del u del x plus del u del x is del u del x. Okay, so D11 is del u del x. Similarly, D22 is del v del y. D33 is del w del z. I am going to finish the class soon. Okay, D33 is del w del z. Okay, similarly, D12 will be equal to D21, because it's a symmetric matrix, which can be written as dxy equal to dyx. What are these? Half into, so D12, right? So del u del y plus del v del x. Okay, so half del u del y plus del v del x. Okay, similarly D21 will be half del v del x plus del u del y, which is the same. It's just the order is changed. Okay, So half del u del y plus del v del x is same as half del v del x plus del u del y. Okay. So that's why d12 is equal to d21. Similarly, you can write d23 equal to d32 like this, and d31 equal to d13 like this. So these are the individual components. And if all the components are present, we can find the magnitude of strain like this. Obviously, we are not going to take in our examples all the components because it's too difficult. We will be assuming some very simple cases where maybe all the components go to zero and only one component remains. Okay, like this we are going to do. But this is the general case. If you are writing a computer program, you have to write like this. Okay, so let us stop here and we will continue this discussion in the next class. Don't leave, I have to take the attendance. Any questions are there, you can ask in the next class. Today we have run out of time. Go through the material, then you will have more questions. Okay. These are quite interesting things. Okay. So, okay, then we'll stop the recording.